Thank you.
Don't let us stand in the way of any liquor.
Exactly. It's a go wild. For sure.
Thank you so much. Ian, say hi to Mom.
I will. Hey, Mom.
All right. So we've got this guava, tequila, and Grand Marnier. Who doesn't love? So somebody had sent me a question if they can substitute Cointreau. You can. It gives you that orange flavor, but Grand Marnier is made with brandy. So if you're going to use Cointreau or Curacao or any other orange liqueur, just add a little brandy for it.
A little what?
Brandy.
Oh, brandy.
All right. Yeah. Here's my mom.
Mom!
Hello.
Hey, Mom. Everybody,
happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving,
everybody. Happy Thanksgiving.
So nice to see you.
Cheers. Cheers.
Cheers to you. We miss you.
I've just had one poured for me downstairs.
Well, don't let us keep you from it.
It's 11 a.m. here, and everyone's like already well into drink mode.
It's not well done.
I just arrived.
It should be.
It's always 5 o'clock somewhere. It's all right.
Exactly. It's always.
Was it Jimmy Buffett?
Yeah.
In the words of Jimmy Buffett.
Absolutely.
All right. Okay. We've got our cocktails. Mm. You guys ready to cheers?
Lisa, Laura, before you cheers, we're going to say goodbye so Gio and Aloe don't feel so sad up front.
Thanks for stopping by. I'm so good to see
you. Love you.
Bye, guys. Adios. Definitely party time.
Thanks for stopping by.
So, we love you.
Adios.
Okay. I forgot to salt the rim.
Whoa.
So have you guys seen tagine before?
I love that. I didn't know about that. We did it with watermelon. I thought it was great.
Tagine.
I went for the low sodium tagine. It's just as good.
It's a classico con lima.
All right.
In the Mission, every store has tagine.
This is true. You guys are gonna have to swap.
It looks beautiful on the rim as well.
This is Jenny's, this is yours, and then, where did mine go? This little guy's mine. Okay, so I got this shaker at the first Salesforce anniversary party.
Wow.
Does anybody know what the very first tagline of Salesforce was?
No software.
Nope.
Oh, no.
I should know, but I think I don't.
Anybody?
No.
Point, click, close.
Oh, I did not know that. Good to know.
Have fun.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. All right, everybody.
Wow.
Well, Thanksgiving cheers.
Yeah, cheers.
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 Cheers. So good to see you all.
Yep.
Oh. Well, what are you drinking? What is that? Manuel, you're muted. Christy, where are you? Christy. Manuel, you're muted.
No, I'm fine.
Christy,
can you hear me?
Oh, hi. Yeah. I'm looking for my tequila.
I've got some.
I'm late and I can't find it, so I'm searching.
A lot.
All right, everybody.
And what are you drinking? What are you drinking?
It's watermelon margarita because I didn't have guava here.
Oh, yeah, it's the last one. Nice.
I, 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 subs, I substituted the guava for watermelon. Yay! Yeah.
You guys like this? Oh, wait, it's very good. You guys like the cocktail?
Oh, love it. It's good. It's a good. It's a good. Yeah.
All right.
Goes well with the salsa, which I made earlier.
It's delicious.
Pretty spicy, but really good.
Oh, good. All right, you guys ready? Now that we've got a few, some alcohol running through our veins, y'all ready to do a little salsa? Yeah.
I'm fortified for the next challenge.
Yeah. Exactly. All right, Manuel.
It's good to be lubricated before we start salsing.
Absolutely.
All right. Take it away.
Are we ready to salsa?
Yeah, I got some here, yeah.
I think we're cooking
it. Okay, well, before we move into the salsa, I need to make an introduction for that because you know what? Say what?
What?
Good. The salsa movement, the salsa music, and the salsa food, or a salsa that we eat, are directly connected. And I don't know if you know that, but if you didn't know, now you know. the different elements of what makes the music and the movement what it is now come from the colloquial interchange of cultural elements, first in Cuba, then Puerto Rico, then Colombia, Venezuela, and Ecuador. And then everything blend, melt, and explode in New York in the late 60s, early 70s. But if you know salsa, or if you have heard salsa, the elements who make salsa as movement, music, and rhythm come from the elements of food. In Cuba, for example, the first traces of what we know about salsa came from what we used to call mambo, and come from the orishas religion from Africa descendants in settlements in Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Dominican Republic. Cubans were the most adventurous in taking the elements of religious thing into the mainstream, actually, or originally kind of prohibited, because there were elements of, you know, the bounce on the drum, the cadence of the drums were used to create this energetic trends into these religious elements that were practicing in certain parts of the society, not the mainstream, always the background. And it's fun because the people who are not connected with the elements, religious elements, love to hear the drums, love to see and watch people bouncing and dancing with the drum, but they were not connected with the elements of the significance or the meaning of it. And it transferred eventually transferred from religious rituals to hiding social gatherings. Like you could have a parties in the 20s and the 30s in Cuba or in Puerto Rico, and people walk into the main door to a traditional minuet, Spanish classic, culturally upscale party, but behind the scenes in the backyard is people dancing and bouncing with the drumming and jumping and having a great time with a different music and different element that eventually grows in from the mambo to the cha-cha. The cha-cha was the jump to make more polished, very bouncy elements and very bouncy and raw elements from the drumming and the performance. And the cha-cha was responsible to make it into the mainstream and into the movies, thanks to immigrations from Cubans, Puerto Ricans to Mexico in the 40s and 50s. And later in New York in the 60s and 70s, actually a Puerto Rican dude called Hector Lavoe. If you have seen the Marc Anthony and Jennifer Lopez El Cantante movie, it's a biopic movie of this guy. He was the first one who blended everything and said, this is like the food. You have a little garlic, you have a little garlic from Puerto Rico, you have a little oil and spices from Mexico, you have a little thing from Cuba, you have another elements from Colombia. This is like a big pile, like a big sauce of elements that make this new sound. And he was the first one to collect to put together a band and kind of label with his first record deal, Viva La Salsa, and kind of put like register the logo, register the name as the new music trend, the new music sound. And this is how we do salsa. And from the food, from the elements of the diversity elements of the food, then we end up learning from Colombians how to move the hips, learning from Cuba how to bounce and make it very strong and very raw, sexually oriented. I'm from Puerto Rico, the sassiness and the double and tender, because every music song from the 40s, 50s, and 60s is always a double and tender between that fine line into what is acceptable and what is not. That is really playful in Latin countries and in Latin music. And today, these days, is all about taking that rhythm into reggaeton, bum, 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 and move the hip, and perreo, or bouncing your butt like Cardi B or whatever. Because what happens now is they take those elements into the super extra X, what can I say? What is the word I want to use? Like super extreme to the other side. Anyway, this is the deal, my friends. I'm going to invite you if you want to stand up, and I'm gonna put some music. Laura, can you make me a co-host to share my music to everybody, and everybody will be able to hear it with nice quality?
Yeah, but last time I made you a co-host, you cut us off, so don't cut us off.
Say that again.
Last time I made you a co-host, you cut us off, so don't cut us off.
What do you mean?
What
are you talking
about? Happen again, clearly.
How do I make you a co-host? Hold on. Oh, I know how. Hold on.
Hey, meringue is like salsa, or are they related?
Meringue is a variation. And it's come from Dominican Republic, and the background of the merengue, it's this is really funny, and it's really funny the stories behind every style. Merengue is it was born in the late 1800s. It was a French invasion to Dominican Republic, and these corsarios, these pirates, when defeated by this army, local army, the general was wounded, and the general in charge of the resistance was wounded, and he was limping. And he was condecorated to save the country. But since he was limping, everybody was accommodating and moving like him to, you know, I don't know.
Dragging the leg.
And that's how merengue started moving. And yeah, if you have seen people dancing merengue is the easiest Latin dance ever, because it's all about marching. It's all about marching, like you are like one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. There is no more science behind the merengue. And that's the story behind that. If I tell you the tango in Argentina was made for men to battle against men to men. It was a form to entertain themselves when they were waiting for their turn into, what is the word in English? In the late 1800s, no, in the early 1900s, Argentina had very small population people, and they were inviting Europeans to come for free, and they were offering free land. If you decide to come, you can have a chunk of land, and you just need to work the land and make and produce something. And then it was an agreement with the government that the government was giving away land if you make the land produce things. Then they have a super habit of men and not so many ladies. Well, the bordels were full of men waiting to mate. Well, the way tango starts, it was this kind of duels, men to men, who was more gracious, who were more courageous, who were more skillful in terms of movement initially.
Like,
they were kind of that. And then everybody's waiting in a line for the terms and the bordel for the few ladies in the country. And everybody outside, the men were just like boom, boom, and practicing and still challenge each other. Well, people romanticize that. Actually, until Evita Perón, tango was seen as the most vulgar and low class ever. It was never in the mainstream ever. It was seen, people who used to approach tango, it was like, ugh, what? You are the lowest class socially. Then what happened? What happened is, of course, like everything. Do you remember Josephine Baker? Josephine Baker moved to France and she put together this review, half naked with bananas around her waist and topless. And it was called a review from tango. It was a very big review from tango. French people were crazy about the moves. And it became like a huge thing when she was invited back to Broadway in the 40s. Then she put up a review in Broadway, Viva el Tango, like Tango Spectacular, and tango became, suddenly everybody's like, what? Oh my God. And it was in the trend. And then Argentina were, wait a second, that's our national dance. Wait a minute, that's our dance, that's ours. That's not Josephine Baker, that's not France. It's our Argentina thing. And suddenly flip from being the most dirty, non-social accepted to the national dance of Argentina. And yeah, and it was dance for men. Then the flower on the mouth and all the romanticism. Actually, the flower was the token that the man was given when it was their turn to go into the inside the room with the lady. And that was how you pass, this is your turn, you pass a flower to the man.
So that's what I'm doing.
The
wrong
fact that the lady used it in the mouth, sometimes, you know, when you take a break from your job, you're outside too. Then the men start dancing with the ladies. They were working and taking a break, but men were dancing with the lady. Then if you notice how they frame the tango, and if you notice how they look away from each other, and the violent and the aggressiveness of the dance between the couple respond to the basic or the original idea that the lady wasn't there to dance with the dude. The lady was just taking a break from the dudes. But the dudes were dueling with each other and practicing with each other. And then suddenly, well, they get in the mix too. And they, oh, with the flower, oh, like, oh, this guy. And the whole physically an element from the tango is just because the roots of it, not because the romantic, oh my God, the lady wants the guy. No, she didn't want the guy. She was like very scared and bored. Anyway, yeah, a little bit of history. Anyway, same thing. Let's go. If you have, can I share my music? Yes, I can share my music. Perfect. Okay, here we go. I'm gonna invite you to stand up. And we're gonna play with music and with rhythm. You're gonna learn the rhythm with your hands. Think about this, my friends. The cha-cha, the mambo, the salsa, the rumba, the cumbia, all of them, except merengue, which is just a march. But all of the Latin rhythm comes from the same origin and the cadence is the same. Cumbia, salsa, mambo, cha-cha, all of them are the same. It's a count of 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And we move. Yeah, there's more, many other elements, but we are not gonna be in Broadway. This is just for fun. And you have already a margarita, which is great. I'm gonna start with slow music from my little brother, Martin. I'm gonna pin my video and we're gonna start standing, please. Can you see me on the big screen? Thumbs up. Can you see me? Yeah. And you can hear the music, yes? Right. Okay, everybody. Now, this is the deal. We're gonna 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That's the rhythm. Let me put this here. There we go. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. On your right foot, let's do the same. This is 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And it's just like a march in three counts. If you got this in place, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. I'm gonna show you how the mambo was meant to move and cha-cha and the salsa, which is the same. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. March in place. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And we're gonna start adding direction. And we're gonna start side to side. God help us. God help us. 4, 3, 2, right foot to the right. What is this? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And what I'm doing is this, moving my feet out, 2, 3, out, 2, 3, out, 2, 3, out, 2, 3. And it's a march. When you feel comfortable with that, then you move a little swing. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And then you make it look like the real thing. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Go back in place. In place. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Now we're going back to back. Right foot back, left foot back. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Now, this is salsa, basic step. It's called basic step. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. But if you move a little bit more to the side, it's cumbia from Colombia. Same move, same rhythm. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Go back to the center. Go back. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And that's it. If we move 1 foot forward, 1 foot back, it's classic salsa. Watch this. Front and back. One front, one back. And if you have seen Dirty Dancing, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's the same move. The same move, Baby and Patrick Swayze in Dirty Dancing. 4, 3, same place, same place. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The mambo, the original mambo in Cuba, use the same three, but we make it a little raw. I'm gonna be side like raw. Oh, like tribal. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. More like almost like, I don't know, like stomping. That's the original mambo. Boom. And, oh, and bam, bam, bam. Same thing, 3, 1, 2, 3. Now, to make it in the mainstream, we move the hip, so we make it more stylish. Hold it here. How was that? Okay, for the next song, what are we gonna do? I'm gonna try to build a little sequence. And this is what we're gonna do. Use the basic step of the salsa. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. We're gonna put direction. We're going back, back, front, and front. Follow me, please. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Let's start. 4, 3, we're going back. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. This is practice. Go back to the center, stay in the center, please. 1, 2, 3. Now we practice going to the front. Both sides. 4, 3, 2. Right foot. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Stay center, center. Now this is what I need from you. We're gonna put 2 to the back, 2 to the front. And we start making like a little routine. Going back, let's go. 1, 2, 1, and 2. Again, go back and back to the front, to the back, to the front. Again, back and back, front and front, back and back. Front. One more. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And just hold it here. Center. March to 3. Center. Now, the cha-cha-cha is the same move, but traveling. What? The cha-cha-cha is the same move, the 1, 2, 3, but we travel. This is what we're gonna do. We're gonna travel forward four times. Watch this. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. Going back. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's the cha-cha-cha. The cha-cha-cha. Move the hip. One, two, three. One, two, three. It's almost, if you have danced before, professionally or at least taking classes, it's like chassé, like rolling. One, two, three. One, two, three. The same move. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's the cha-cha-cha. It's just moving. One, two, three. And if you go to Puerto Rico or Cuba or Colombia and you're dancing in the street, it's all about moving your body. You really want to push it, move it. Oh. And shake it. And boom, boom, boom. Of course, the guys always want to be seen or to show off the girls that we are dancing with. Now this is it. Everybody in place, in place, in place. One, two, three. One, two, three. Let's put those two together. Four corner salsa and the cha-cha traveling. Why four corner? Do this. One, two, three, four. Then we travel, 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 travel back, travel back. Okay. And two. March it. Just march. Yes, let's start again. Four, three, right foot goes back. One, two, three, four. Then we cha cha cha, cha cha cha. And stay there because the music stopped. How is it going? How is it going so far? Okay, this is what I'm gonna do just to create like a little routine for today. We're gonna go travel two to the front, two to the back, and then we the original cha-cha, it's about showcase the skills of the guy leading the lady, but usually the guy is the one who framed the lady, and in ballroom dance it's all about her moving and make her be the star. Let's do this. We're gonna move this your feet in the same way. One, two, three. This is the basic move. Basic pattern is one, two, three. One, two, three. But what if? What if? Instead of moving only the feet, we start not moving the feet, but moving the hip. What? This. One, two, three. 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 Cha, cha, cha. One, two, three. Cha, cha, cha. One, two, three. One, two, three. Boom, boom, boom. Cha, cha, cha. Cha, cha, cha. Just march on your right foot. Okay, this is what we're gonna do. We go for the salsa four corners. We travel the cha-cha two times to the front, two times to the back, and then we add the hip. Let's see. Go ahead, let's see. Four, three, four corner salsa. Here we go. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. Now the cha-cha travel. One and two. Now back, back. Now the hip, the hip, the hip. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. And mark. We do it again. Four, three, two. Four corners. Corners. Forward. One, two. Travel. Pam, pam. Go back, go back. No, hip, hip, hip. One, two, three, and four. And walk. Yes. And four and three, do it again. Salsa back. One, two, three, two, four. Cha cha. Cha cha. Back. Now the hip to the right. Four, three, two, one. And this swing. Play merengue. Five, six. Salsa, we go. Back. Forward. Cha cha. Back. The hip, watch it. One, two, pop. One, two, boom. One, two, oh, five. And merengue. Four, three, salsa, last one, please. One, two. One, two. Cha cha. Cha cha cha. Cha cha cha. Back. The hip. One, two. Cha cha cha. One, two, and four. One more time. Go. Come on. And travel. Back. Give me the hip. One, oh, two, boom, three, oh, four, and move. One more time. The song is still. Come on. I still have music. Back. Give me the hip. Choom, choom, oh. Choom, choom, two. Boom, four, three. Four. Okay, this move, let's do this. This is one, two. Other side. One, and two. And we turn. Yep. This is our final touch. Everybody stay in the center. Just march. Four corners, the salsa goes. Hey, one, two. Cha-cha-cha back. The hip. Oh, two, five, three, four. And one, and two, and one. Last time, we go. We got it. Two. One, two. One, two, march it back, cha-cha-cha-cha, hold it here. Yay! How was that? How was that?
Great.
Awesome. Thanks, Manuel. You are the best.
Thank you very much. I know.
Can you have a drink now?
Ah, look.
Thank you so much, Manuel. It was so interesting.
Did you get it?
Pretty lesson, isn't it?
Kind of, not very well.
Did you dance it? Because I was unable to see all of you.
She got it.
Was it hard? Sure. Was it too hard?
It was perfect.
Was it?
Woo! Yeah. It was great. I love you so much.
Awesome.
I love it so much. I'm practically a dance historian now.
Kevin, were you chop-chopping while you were cooking? Manuel, thank you so much. I had no idea about the history.
Yeah, that was awesome.
There is a lot of fun. Really interesting ways to get to know, or you know, when you get to know what was behind the whole idea of it and how it was born, it's just really fun. I wrote a book 2006 about, it's called Ay Caramba. Yeah, it's for the fitness industry, how to teach instructor how to dance or to learn all these dances and teach them. It's a practical exercise book. Right now I'm working with a second edition because I want to extrapolate and to share with people all the story or these stories that are documented everywhere and put it out again, and second edition is coming next year. COVID has been very, very, very good for me. COVID has helped me to see things differently. And I think I'm editing now to publish next year.
Awesome.
And share a lot of these stories.
Is it only in Spanish or is it in English as well?
In English. Yeah. I think I'm going to have both because, of course, I was born and raised in Puerto Rico. Like the other day, I post on Facebook and my story, one joke in English, and my mother immediately just texts me, hey, your mother do not understand the English. Just, you need to put it in Spanish. Then I put it in Spanish, and then 3 days later, she sent me another text. Hey, I sent you to Mexico as a nice person. What are you talking about? Because words in Mexico here in Spanish, some of them aren't bad words in Puerto Rico. And I said, well, mother, I am in Mexico now. Yeah, but you're still Puerto Rican. Yeah, but it's Facebook. Yeah, but that sounds like a bad. You know, anyway, I can win.
Your mother is always right.
I know. That's why I love her. And she's crazy. If you see this craziness, that she's two times me.
Moms are always yeah. right. Manuel, tell us what's going on at Rancho La Puerta. Fill us in.
What's going on? Well, I'm going to describe this situation. I'm going to describe the situation as a weekly challenge. Some weeks you feel like you are in the summer drinking a nice bubbly rosé and enjoying the wind. And some weeks you feel that you need a double bourbon. Man. Yeah. Not everybody, Rancho La Puerta is a U.S. organization or company it's a U.S. company with a Mexican resort. That means we need to comply with all HR in the U.S. and California and all HR in Mexico, which is really interesting. There is a lot of things that we need to do to be safe in both sides of the border. Right now, Mexico is been in yellow. Next week is gonna change. We are going back to orange, which means we were able to accept up to 50% of our guests. Now we need to go down to 30% if we go back to orange because of COVID. And then we have to release employees too. We cannot operate with more than 30% of employees or 30% of guests if we change to orange. From yellow, we were, for the last month, we've been in yellow, which is good. We were hosting 50% of our capacity. People cope with COVID differently. And we all are, as humans, we cope with stress challenges differently. Some weeks people are already freaking out in every way and you have to be patient and you have to be very professional. And some weeks is joyful and it's nice and people are really aware of their physical distance, wearing the mask, standing on their spots. We have to measure spots in every gym. The yoga studio, we used to accommodate up to 75 people. We cannot put more than 20 now. Same with the scope and strength, same with the cycle, every studio now has spots marked on the floor where people should stay. And some people are really willing to comply and some people are very challenging. Very challenging. Like this week I had a situation in which we have to call concierge to help because they were not compliant. They were making other guests very uncomfortable. And suddenly we have a situation between three guests in the same room. And it was unnecessary, but everybody feels different about what they should do. And I'm sorry.
You had a throuple?
Yeah. Then I'm an instructor, I'm a provider, I'm a coach, I'm a wellness resource. I am not a referee and I am not a police. Then when things go that way, yeah, I have to call management and they need to jump in because like we have 20 people in the room, but 6 feet apart, everybody, and you wearing masks. If you walk around, you have to keep your mask on. If you feel comfortable enough not to wear it, you cannot move from your spot. If you decide not to wear your mask, you need to stay there. Stay put. Well, that's a challenge for some people because some people don't want to be told what to do. Even under business circumstances, then yeah. Anyway. It's great. I have a job. This is my living room. I have to transform my living room into a Zoom thing. I'm teaching classes at the ranch regularly, but I do have a Zoom schedule, live stream schedule through Facebook, Instagram, and my private Zoom classes. And I'm working a lot more now because I used to travel 2 weekends every month to different places around the world. Now the world is in my house. I was teaching to people in India last Friday, 65 people in India, and then two Fridays ago, 46 in Malaysia. Sculpt and strength and dance. And I'm here still in Tecate in Mexico, but I still connecting. I save on flights, Uber, Starbucks, and airport taxis, TSA challenges, and I can have my dream between sessions.
No jet lag,
exactly.
Fantastic. Oh, thank you so much for sharing that.
Yeah, totally.
You're gonna share a different, you're gonna teach us a different salsa each week now.
Really? That's awesome.
Laura, are you gonna hold me 3 weeks again?
Yep, we're going back to every week. So
yay!
Are your Zoom classes public? Like, can we join to?
Yeah. So you can. Some of them are Mondays and Tuesday. They are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. They are private. But you can always contact me, and I can send you the link, and you can join.
Okay.
But Manuel, if you send me all your info, I'll post it on my website.
Perfect. Yeah.
And then we'll be doing these every Friday going forward.
Mm-hmm. Yay!
And then what I want to do in January, I want to start back our dinners, and I want to do some classes, like a cooking 101 class, if you guys are interested in it. Like, 1 week we'll do braising, the next week searing and stocks and soups and knife skills and chocolate and all the different, if you guys are interested in that. And then I want to do a wine class every week. And then also two of the people that popped on from Mexico, two of them are authors. So Shelley, who wrote Soulbatical, and then Justin, who popped on at the end, he wrote a book called Get Woke. And so I'm going to start a series in January called Cooks and Books. So we'll have we'll have them come on with their book. We'll do a little kind of mini book club, and I'll plan a meal around the theme of the book. So
that sounds fun,
right?
Awesome.
So I'll drink. When you have your book out, we'll do a tango. We'll do a cha 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 meal.
Yeah. Yeah. So, we're gonna do a cha 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 blast.
So that's what I'm putting together to start next year. I'll do a couple Christmas cooking classes or holiday classes, like holiday cookies and
vodka and latkes.
Oh my god.
I'm in.
I like vodka better than tequila.
So I'll do a few Christmas cooking classes, holiday latke, vodka latkes, and then we'll start a full schedule in January.
Yay!
So we'll go back to our weekends and a lot of you were kind enough to ask me about my little mini sabbatical. I went down there for 2 weeks and I extended it to 4. When I got down there, what I realized was I really want to write our quarantine cooking cookbook. And I want to take all the recipes that we did for those 12 weeks. But I also want to include interviews with all the guests that came on. So Manuel, all the winemakers, all the distillers, the quail farmer, all the actors and singers. And then I would love to have little interviews with all of you, because you were my core posse through those 12 weeks. And so incorporate interviews with all of them, incorporate interviews with all of you, and just make a really cool quarantine cookbook. So that came to me when I was down there. So I extended for 4 weeks. And then I realized that if I came back after 4 weeks, I'd be coming back the day before the election. And that was mildly horrifying. So I just did not want to be here in the U.S. on election day. So
I don't know what you're talking about.
So I I asked the one of the founders of it, I said, is there any way I can extend? And she said, we're all full unless somebody cancels. That night, somebody canceled. So the next morning at 6 a.m., I got an email saying, somebody just canceled. Do you want their room for 2 weeks?
Wow.
I said, yes. So that's why I stayed down there for 6 weeks.
And she got to be my neighbor.
Yes.
Chippy, my neighbor.
So Kathy,
it isn't over yet, you know.
Right. So yeah, it was amazing. It's this place. It's called the Modern Elder Academy. If you look it up online, Modern Elder Academy is a .com.
For all of us that have the requisite, you know, gray hair, modern elders.
It was founded by a guy named Chip Conley, who was here in San Francisco. He founded the Joie de Vivre Hotels. So the Phoenix Hotel. Chuck, Kevin, Tracy, I know. Christy, I know you guys all know that hotel. He went on, the chain of boutique hotels like Hotel Vitale. And then he went on to, he was hired at Airbnb to mentor the three 20-something founders. And through his time there and working with these 20-somethings, he wrote a book called Wisdom at Work.
Wisdom at Work.
What do you need, bud?
It was called is she talking to her mom or me? it was called Wisdom at Work, The Making of a Modern Elder. And it really talked about how at 50, they're 50 and up, there's so much we have to contribute. We have so much experience, you know, we're not on the downward slope, we're not looking at retirement. We have so much to contribute to the world. And so he wrote this book, and from that book, he developed this program called the Modern Elder Academy. And it's really centered around, he had a vacation home in an hour north of Cabo, and he built around it, he added two buildings front and back to it, and he created this academy, and it's usually a week-long immersion, and it's all these, pipe in here, Lisa, Kathy, it's a one-week immersion, we're learning about...
So you talk about things like mindset... appreciative inquiry, or do your values align with your actions, all of this stuff while you're in transition just to kind of help you maybe be on the path you want to be on.
Right.
So yeah. And you're with like-minded people. It's phenomenal.
Yeah, exactly. And so what they did was during COVID, they couldn't do these week-long immersions. So they took the six main components of their curriculum and spread it out 2 hour blocks three times a week for 2 weeks. And then the rest is all free time. And so, oh darn, we had to go to the beach. We had to go to the beach. And we had to go sit by the pool. And we had to go watch the little baby sea turtles hatch from their little eggs and go into the ocean. And it was absolutely magical. I didn't realize how burned out I was from the fires, the smoke, being laid off, the politics, the, what else was going on? COVID, the political vitriol that was coming at us from every direction. And I just had to check out. And it was—
Hey, Laura, can I just say that what you did with the issues, with the fires, you know, you got to believe there's some universal something that knew that you needed to be there, and you were there, and thank you so, no, I mean it. It was so meaningful what you did for the folks that were so distraught with the fires. So the universe is looking for you.
Yeah, karma. Come on, works.
Here, here, here's to Laura.
Yeah.
Laura. Giving and
cheers. Thank you so much. Cheers. Thank you, Megan. You know, I agree, because if I hadn't been laid off, I never would have been able to do that. And it was such an honor to be able to do that, to use what I've trained for in such a good way. And, you know, it was so meaningful to hand meals to people who were on the front lines of the fires, and hand meals
to evacuee, I'm choking up, to hand meals to evacuees in their hotel rooms was just, it was incredible. And I have to keep, that's why I went to cooking school. That's why I did it. It wasn't to work in a Michelin star restaurant. It was to feed people, you know, and that's Jose Andreas's philosophy. It's like, we're here to feed people care for people. And so, you know, my big dream would be to work for that organization, but because what they do is just so remarkable. It's just, it's pure love, pure helping people. And so thank you for that. It was probably, you know, it was funny when they only hand out t-shirts. They hand out t-shirts with the World Central Kitchen very, very sparingly. And the first week I did there up in Vacaville, at the end of the week, they gave me a t-shirt and I just burst into tears. I mean, it's a dumb t-shirt, but it meant so much to me because only the staff gets them. And I wore it every day.
Every day
in Mexico, I wore it. And
people asked, which was perfect. People have asked about what is the World Kitchen. So it's perfect. And can I just say cheers to you and Manuel for another pivot in COVID and pulling this group together, which I'm sorry, I didn't know about it earlier, but you know, to pull a group of people together to do something phenomenal like this, build community and feel connected to people at a time when we are feeling the most disconnected. Mm-hmm. So Manuel, I don't know you. Laura, you're my new best friend.
Can I say something? It's all Laura. I jump in because I really love her. I met her the first time she came here at the ranch as a newbie 11 years ago. And we click and we remain friends all these years. But she was the one who really get the pulse of the COVID thing. And we were locked down here and at the ranch March 16. And she immediately called me, hey, I have this thing going on. Do you want to jump in and help me? And I said, duh, that sounds incredibly... That sounds incredible. That sounds, I never heard something like that before. And she is the motor and the oil that make this work. I'm just jump and I just help, but she is the brain and she should have a show on TV.
Yes, she should. The last thing the Food Network needs is another middle-aged white woman.
HGTV, they do shows.
She should have. She should have a show on the Cook Network, the Food Network, somewhere. But she's really smart, talented, and she was really fast to catch up and to. Okay, what we're gonna do? We need to do something blah, 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 and put it together and make it work and make it happen.
Cooking from home. How many of us just want to know how to do this in our own home? Like, I love this. You're doing this right here in your own home where we can all learn. It's perfect. Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you for
on that note.
So it turns out, so I had to go to Mexico to meet Lisa, who lives like four blocks away. But we realized today that from my balcony and her balcony, we can see each other.
Well, I mean, Laura, I had to go to Paris to meet you, and you were living.
Right, see, okay. But you went further.
I don't know that's the way it is with Laura. I don't know why. You have to travel really far away to meet her.
I have to travel further to see who I meet next.
Well, Lynn came in from Australia, so. So,
but I met you in San Francisco.
See, that was a long trip for you.
Well, no, I was living there.
Oh, okay. Sounded better there for a second.
We can recreate.
I'm so grateful to all of you who just came in every week and showed up. And it was so interesting when I came back from Mexico. We got in Sunday night, and this whole week I've been so bummed out. I've been like a cat without whiskers. I've been so out of sorts. And then I woke up this morning and I don't know what happened, but something just clicked and I feel so much better and a much brighter outlook. And one of the things that I realized was that in Mexico, so every morning I would get up really early. So Kathy, you left and I took over coffee duty. And I'd get up really early, like at 5 o'clock in the morning. So those of you who know me, yes, I was up at 5 in the morning. And thank
morning, turn on the coffee. And that was,
oh my God.
I know, right? And that time, and I'd sit out, so the building that we were in was right on the beach. The ocean was right there, the Pacific Ocean. And the ocean was just pounding. The part where we're at, it's called Pescadero Beach. And it was the surf just pound. And it was just the most amazing sound. And I'd sit there in the morning and I'd make my coffee. And Lisa would wake up and come over in her Giants onesie. And just those mornings, like there'd be just Lisa and I, and then there'd be like six or seven or eight of us. And what I, and then at night, because I moved rooms, so I was right next to Lisa and Kathy. And at night I'd knock on their door and I'd go in and we'd do a little debrief on the day. And what I realized, it really occurred to me this morning, was how much I missed being with people. Like there was, you know, we were all safe. We were all outside. All the classes were outside. All the eating, all of our meals were outside. You know, we're on the beach. It was all outside, so it was really safe. So we were at this huge table like I have here. Like, this is the thing, is that I've missed so much having people around this table. And what I realized was how much I missed being in community. And then to come back here and be completely isolated again was so hard. But I think I just need to keep this in touch with people and keep, you know, seeing faces and hearing voices and checking in and making sure people are really okay, because here we go again, another 3 or 4 months of this craziness. And know who it's safe to hug so you can get...
Hey, Laura, can I share a picture from MEA? I think I can share my screen on here. Oh, nope. I can't share.
Hold on, what do I need to do? Let me, can I make you co-host?
Just enable sharing screens.
Do this. Hold on. You're asking me. I have no idea.
I don't either, but it says it's disabled. I figured that out.
Okay.
Laura, am I going to have to go down and get Tony?
Yeah. IT.
Tracy's husband is our tech support. He works at Zoom.
Oh, that's funny.
That's so fantastic.
We need to talk.
Okay, how do I do this? I'll make you a co-host.
Yeah, that's the easiest way.
Kathy, now try it.
Just need to enable. Okay.
Now, can you do it, Kath?
Yep.
Boom, Kathy's sharing.
It's Laura and Stella. This was probably 5 o'clock, 5:30 in the morning. That's the moon behind them.
That was the moon, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that was the moon. So I had never seen that before in my life. That was the moon set.
Wow. Oh my God.
Amazing, huh?
Really early in the morning. Yeah.
It looks like the sun.
It was the moon. It was the moon setting. Wow. Is that wild?
That's interesting. I didn't even know the moon set. I never thought about it because I'm never up at 5:30 maybe.
There were some moon sets. Very orange, looked just like the sun.
Kathy, where was this?
This was Pescadero Beach, right in front of MEA.
It's
where we were staying.
Baja. So, James, hour north of Cabo.
Okay. Because the last couple of weeks, I went to Tanzania and climbed Mount Kilimanjaro.
Oh, you did? Oh, my God.
And I've done a safari, and I've seen lions and hippos and giraffes and everything. It's to go to a place where literally... COVID doesn't exist, and then and see all this stuff. So it's
I want to see your photos, James.
I might be able to share. I don't know if I'm on my iPad, so it's not really possible, but I think.
Okay.
I'll show you guys one more just so you can see the set. This was probably the same day. The morning. That was the morning.
That's a cactus, very, very tactical.
Yeah.
Is that the moon or is that the sun? Is that the moon or the sun?
That's crazy.
Kathy, was that the moon setting?
Yeah. This was that same morning that we went out on the beach. This was just earlier.
Just sitting and having coffee. Wow.
Yep.
I could share some pictures of safaris in Tanzania if someone made me or whatever.
But oh, yes.
Did you go to Tanzania this year during COVID?
Yeah, I went 2 weeks ago.
Really? They don't...
Wow.
Wait, so you were on a flight? Obviously, yeah. Flights in and out, no problem.
Yeah, yeah, there's no
other Ebola, you know, quarantine. I'm joking.
You come to... Well, there's no, they don't do any testing for COVID.
They must have rebooked your flight at least 15 times. Like,
I did. I had to do a bit of rebooking, but this is me in my background here on the
oh, wow.
This is on top of Kilimanjaro, yeah. So
we did it last October. Did it take you 5 days to get up?
We did like 8 days, so 7 days to go up, so super slow, and then
1 day to come down.
Yeah, but there were only like 12 people. It was so quiet, there was hardly anyone going up. It was super quiet, which was cool. So
oh, that's awesome.
No, it was and I don't know if actually we can, I can't share anything, I guess.
I made you a co-host. You can't share, I
want to
see some animals.
I'm on an iPad, so maybe it's a bit tricky.
So I'll share some stories that I thought, parts of the story I thought were shocking.
Did you go, Kevin?
Four people, no, but I've heard it already. Four people go up, guess how many people they had carrying their stuff?
12?
Yeah.
30, right? It was like, we had 8 people carrying their stuff, it's crazy.
We were employing a lot of people.
Which is good, it's good for the economy.
Cool. Yeah, it was great for the economy.
Wow. They make no money. It's, you know, it's really crazy how little they get paid.
Yeah, it was nuts. They're like $5 a day, and so we tipped them well. And equally, I was super surprised. I was expecting it to be really lame, like going to a zoo. But no, they were amazing. There were elephant, there were zebra, lions, everything. And you got like 6 feet away, 2 meters for the Australians, there's a male lion just like walking past as if he doesn't care in the world, you know?
Oh. Maybe we should plan some dinners where people like show their pictures. Like we do a whole dinner around like James' trip and he gets to share his photos and we cook.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome. That'd be great.
African.
The foods of that.
Yeah.
Ethiopian.
Area and
living vicariously through other people.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, we could all learn something.
That's a great idea.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
Look at you.
I think it'd be great.
I'm loving the salsa. The salsa is really good.
Lisa's the new concierge at Modern Elder Academy.
She does. Guilted me out today by saying I went for a COVID test because I'm going upstate. Just have it, you know. I got a COVID test yesterday. I'm clean.
So James, next time, come on your laptop so you can share your pictures with us.
Yeah, I don't know why I can't share even on my iPad. It seems a bit weird.
You should be able to share.
Yeah.
Although,
cool.
Thanks so much.
Have to get Tony in
because.
Yeah, we might need Tony.
We've all seen pictures of lions and stuff. I mean, the hippos.
Did you see monkeys?
Whaties?
Monkeys.
Baboons and some monkeys with blue balls, which was a bit unusual.
Really? Wow, that would be very.
Yeah.
There's so many different types of monkeys over there. It's crazy.
Wow.
I don't want to know why their balls are blue.
Those poor monkeys. I feel sorry for them.
Got a good idea why.
Anyway, moving on.
You guys want to make some salsa?
Yeah. I am loving the salsa. It's so good.
Salsa.
Awesome.
Oh, salsa is awesome. I've already made it earlier on.
And oh, amazing. All right.
I made it while we were dancing. I was dancing.
It's pretty tasty.
I'm gonna pivot back here to the kitchen.
Yay.
And then we will make our salsa. Manuel, thank you so much, Manuel. Thank you so much.
Well,
I gotta go.
Buonissimo.
Bye, everybody. Thank you so much.
Hey, Kathy, good to see you.
Nice to meet you all.
Stay warm.
Thanks for coming on, Kathy. She's gone. She's out. All right, you guys, I've never made this before.
Manuel, so. Do you have any more dance classes tonight, or are you done for the day?
No, I'm done for the day. I have a jar full of margarita for tonight.
Hallelujah.
Put a melon.
Party at Manuel's, right?
Another important part of Mexican culture. Arriba, abajo, acentro.
Acentro, adentro.
All right.
It's giving me trouble, the Mexican culture. My mother doesn't like that I am kind of a, I'm a little Mexican now. I've been here 11 years. Of course, it's unavoidable. You're going to catch some things.
Are you Puerto Rican regionally? Where are you from?
Born and raised in Puerto Rico. 11 years ago, I had this chance to come here, and I moved here. And since then, I think I'm going to retire here.
Wow.
It's a lovely country.
It does, maybe not at the ranch, but I'm pretty sure a friend of mine, we've been talking, like, it's so different, the lives here. Mexican culture is so interesting. And even though they are not necessarily in the most abundance, maybe. Yeah. It doesn't matter. There's a joyful feeling all over the place. And in the air, you can breathe. People are happy. People are nice. They're always making jokes.
Yeah.
And it's, I like that. I like that feeling. It doesn't matter.
It's different too from state. I don't know if you get down to Guadalajara. I spent 3 months down there. I loved it so much. You know, the home of the mariachis.
Yeah.
You know.
But Manuel, you're not even 40 yet, so you've got a long time to live.
No, I'll always go, bud.
listen. I'm 82 this year. And it hasn't been great. Being 82 under COVID and this situation is not the right thing. Anyway. No, I look younger, but I am not that young anymore. But I'm thinking.
You're not
really, it's really sad.
American man to say he's not so young anymore. Is that like a?
That's an exaggeration. 82, Jesus.
Yeah, he's 72.
Listen, I can pass the phone and contact with my plastic surgeon. Is that
It's a lot more affordable now in Mexico, that's for sure.
if you go to TJ.
TJ.
You get your life.
I grew up in Palm Desert. So sometimes we would ditch high school and drive down to TJ. This is before it got really bad. And go drinking down there on La Avenida de Revolucion. It was all these fun bars and stuff.
Yeah, right now it's way different because the last 4 years had changed a lot, the border crossing and all the government technicalities. Yeah. But still fun.
I went to San Diego State for undergrad, and
there you go.
All cool kids went down to TJ.
Boy,
drinking. I was not a cool kid.
She
so
wasn't
I live the TJ. My mom kept my passport.
I went to the University of Redlands, and we went to TJ all the time.
Oh, you're from Redlands! Yeah. Oh my gosh! Wow!
Yes.
Totally, right?
Yeah.
It's like a Southern California thing.
First time, not for me.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
You guys people, ready to make some salsa?
People know how to party and how to have fun and be happy here.
Yeah, they do.
Are you in your home or are you at the studio?
Who are you talking with?
Yeah, are you in your home or are you at the
No. I don't have any more studio. I was during the COVID, I was using a guest lounge here at the ranch. Management has been so magnificent with me. Of course. I've been really accommodating too, but they helped me to take over a guest lounge, transform it as a Zoom studio. Happens when we open in September 5th. My boss wanted to keep it, but the general manager thought that maybe that was not a good idea because we have people who come here and has been coming for maybe 40 years, 30 years, 28 years, and they know all the gimmicks behind the scenes. And that lounge is the only lounge that has a TV with cable TV. And this is a Wi-Fi cell phone and technology free, which means you don't have Wi-Fi anywhere except in two lounges. You don't have access to anything like TV or thing anywhere except for that lounge. Then people start like, complaining. Of course, that if you've been here for 30 years, every year, and you are used to go to watch whatever, and this instructor is taking over for streaming his classes. And I was not the only one. There were 7 instructors streaming. I created a calendar. I became the manager of the room. We were doing great until, we had to surrender. Now I sold my furniture. This is my living room. I bought a new carpet and lighting, and there is lights every corner just to make sure I can see myself because it's very dark. And now I'm swimming from my living room. This is my casita.
And you have Wi-Fi, obviously.
When you pay protection, you get protected. I talk with the IT guys, and then the IT guys are a friend of mine, and they hook me up. They create for me a Ethernet connection because the Wi-Fi is very unstable here. Then I have a cable who goes directly to a modem, who goes to the mothership, and then voila.
Well done. It always pays to grease the palms of the IT guys, for sure.
There you go. You pay protection, you get protected.
Yeah. Oh, welcome to Latin America.
El hueso.
James, my mom's commenting on your cocktail. Your margarita.
Do you like it, Mom?
Looks fabulous.
Oh, good. Did you have one?
Yes, please.
So, Laura, I'm excited to see you make this because I want to make sure I did it right. I already made mine. I'm eating it, but...
Oh, I'm sure you did.
I think I made a mistake along the way, but it still tastes good.
Oh, good. I know you did.
You know, the good thing is after the second one, is great.
Especially after the second margarita. Let me tell you.
Oh.
Brandy. Who would have known Brandy was the Grand
Marnier? How many shots of Brandy should I be adding to him?
Just not all me. Like,
great, guys, you with me? Who's cooking with me?
All right, ready.
Christy, are you cooking with me?
No, I was going to, but our guests arrived early, so I've aborted.
I think you're on your own here, basically.
Chef Megan, are you cooking or are you just drinking?
No, we already made it. We're eating it.
I'm making candles right now.
Do you like it?
Pioneer woman. I'm not kidding. I'm making candles. I'm a pioneer woman.
Wow.
Christy, are you cooking or are you drinking?
I'm not cooking, but I'm going to refill.
I'm watching, drinking, and I'm eating the Costco veggie plate right now. I'm not sure about the peanuts, so I'm debating about making it.
Well, it's awesome. The peanut salsa, bomb.
Yeah.
Let's see how it's made.
I'm going to watch.
I don't do chilies, so it's major chili action, but it's really good.
I did it for margarita, so I'm sure I would love it. So,
Tracy, where are you now?
Where am I now? Or the picture of myself? I'm in Marietta. That's Lake Merritt in Oakland.
Oh, I wish you were in Lake Merritt.
Well, in January, I'll be in California. So I will stop by and visit. And hopefully it'll be when you're doing one of your shows. I can be like a little help.
I'll do a live one with Tracy. All right, so I'm going to start on this. So I've got the oil, medium heat. I'm going to put 2 tablespoons of
her and I've been talking.
Yes.
And then is that the garlic?
No, this is the actually I should wait until
That was sesame. Okay.
The chilies, the sea stem, the chilies. I wasn't able to get guajillo. I don't know what these are, but I just bought them.
You know, it's funny. In the United States, guajillo peppers aren't labeled guajillo peppers. They're labeled pasilla peppers.
Yes.
Oh, it's like, it's the weirdest. This one pepper has three different names. It's incredible. It depends on the state of its preparation.
I think the pisco is the dried and smoked version.
Yeah. You know,
I love Mexican food, so I've been through the guajillo torture chamber before. Let me tell you.
You're
like, why can't I find a guajillo pepper? You search. Like, where is that damn pepper? I'm in the mission. This is where all the Mexican food is, for Christ's sake. Why don't they have one?
A question I have.
They call it a pasilla pepper here, that's why.
Laura, can I get a word in here? The question was, should you be soaking the peppers you recommended for like 20 minutes in water before whatever, you said stemming them? What does stemming mean? Is it like shaking the seeds out, or is it just dropping the, what do you mean?
So de-stem means take the stem off.
Yeah, but I mean, I shook the seeds out of the little red.
I took the seeds out
too. Yeah, that's good. The heat is in the seeds.
Yeah, but the big black fella. I mean, but I also read a thing online that you should maybe soak them for a while before you do that to open them up a bit. But I didn't do that. I just whacked them in. But
that's whacking is good. no, you can. It doesn't matter.
By the way, I was able to find them no problem here at Lake Tahoe. So there you
bowl.
Go.
Yeah, our bowl, no problem. It's the other one. It's the guajillo.
How is
the guajillo?
Uh huh.
I made the simplified version.
So, the little one or the big one?
How's the guajillo?
I see you, Manuel.
Everybody, wait to Manuel.
Let's do it.
The guajillos, arriba. They add the plumpness. They add the juicy. They add that kind of. They just add a really nice,
soft one. Yeah.
Well, you're so transparent. Then, well, are you going to stay with us? Are you going to keep?
Yeah, duh.
Are you cooking with us, Manuel, or are you just not? You've eaten already.
No, I did the salsa earlier today. I already is gone.
Really? Wow.
It is gone. It is gone, 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 gone.
Good Lord. Good thing you do a lot of exercise.
I had two classes this morning, two Zooms, and then this is the third one. I need some energy.
Yeah.
I mean, the peanuts do make it like a food almost, right? The protein in there, it's really nice.
It's a whole meal, that
Mm. Every food group is represented. Do you guys know how to? Do you want me to do my onion, or do you guys all know?
Yeah, we know.
Let's do it.
Right. See, I'm intrigued by your sideways slice of the onion. What's the point of that?
All right, horizontal slices. Keep your fingertips.
Well, those slices. What's the point of the ones where you go horizontally? There's no point because the onion is already.
No, it's smaller pieces. It's all about dicing. Okay.
So you just put your tip down, go straight down.
I go for the verticals, but the horizontal slices seem a bit redundant in my book.
Well, you breathed.
Don't worry about them. You can live without it.
But then go straight down.
Because it's already slicey in that.
Well, it's a difference between a dice and a fine dice. How about that?
Oh, I love the Laura's cutting board angle. Look at that. Boom.
Right?
And you've got an arbol. You've got like a jar of arbols there.
I do. So have you guys heard of Penzi Spices?
Yeah, that place is amazing.
So that's where I got all these. They've got a ton of different chilies. They probably have guajillo, but I didn't get my act together in time to order some.
Can you turn me on to that?
All right, so. Mm. Going. All right.
You've literally got dried chilies in there, right?
Yep. Literally.
Literally.
I love her. I know. James, just talk.
No, I'm intrigued. I think that horizontal slice in the onion is redundant.
Oh no, it makes it smaller. It's genius.
It doesn't. It doesn't make it smaller at all.
Look at it there. Look at that.
Onion is in that
It's geometry.
I want to challenge Laura to an onion slice-off.
Good God. Don't.
I want to see it. I want to see it. I want
to
see
it. He'll just ask like some like electronic device to do it for him. Like, here, take care of that.
It's the difference between slicing the extra way and not. I think there is a knot.
Well, if you've seen QVC, there's an easy way, no electronic. It's just a thing that you put the onion under and then you cook.
No, no, there's a
shove it like crazy.
Actually, I've seen Jacques Pépin do the same technique that Laura just showed. Laura used to work for him sometimes. So, I mean, it's like
I will go back into the future and exhume August Escoffier and tell him of your concerns.
Yeah, right.
All right, we got sesame seeds, chilis, garlic. I haven't
done
garlic. Oh my God.
The garlic in there, you
got to
prepare.
That was a lot of garlic. I chopped it up. I was like, oh my God, this is a lot of garlic.
It was like 10 garlic cloves. That's going to take ages to like.
Eight. I'm not
going to
do, I'll do. These are pretty big ones.
Actually, it was fine. I love it. Eight was fine.
But peeling them took a while. So.
Kevin, you're a vampire.
Yes, I am.
No, I took a bunch of them, but it took a while to. That was the longest item in this recipe, was peeling the garlic and then chop.
Laura, I sense another learning moment right here.
I agree.
Is that like an FU moment?
Or there's another chef tech. You might not accept it, James. You might think it's like more kind of conspiracy theory, but look at it. She's going to show you.
No, I mean, top tip, Laura, read the recipe before you make it. Not what I'm saying, but.
All the way through. Okay, here's, so you cut the ends off the garlic, smash it, and then you smash it.
Or you could do some pre-mashed garlic, you know.
Oh, boy, that's
bad. Gee, I told you you'd have a robot do it for him.
Blasphemy.
Like mashed garlic is a different taste from chopped garlic.
So easy, just smash it under your blade, boom.
But like mashed is a different taste from chopped.
And then it pops out. Well, you have to mince it, by the way, so you're not done. So she's just
doing like garlic three ways. You can do like minced, chopped, and roasted.
James, I'm gonna mute you.
Sorry.
Minced, chopped, roasted.
You know, we need like cooking conspiracy theory show now, honestly.
Yeah,
you know, cooking conspiracy show.
Who has a guava margarita? Anyone guava margarita?
All right, here we go.
Anyone guava here's margarita?
Chopped it. Same Kevin. Grip. Fingers on the blade. Thumb and finger on the blade. Three fingers on the handle.
And Manuel, melon margarita.
Watermelon margarita.
There's hardly anything in there. It's like a watermelon like essence in the bottom of that glass.
Well, because it's gone. I need to refill now.
Well, don't let us, you know, off you go. Go and fill up.
I have to say, I love that. That watermelon margarita was kind of my favorite. I really love that.
Awesome. That was yummy.
It is.
But you're also a health professional, so I appreciate your need to, like, keep it clean, you know?
Well, at least you put something, some elements, like, it's natural. That's my secret for retirement.
Although I got this from Kevin's like natural, all natural, like monster container of guava juice, not natural. What does it say?
Guava nectar! I'm concentrate. I can't believe it. It was crazy.
So I
actually thought I was going to try to make it, Laura. I went to the store, I looked for them. I'm like, oh, I don't, they're out of season.
So while that's cooking, I'm going to put the stuff in here. So I'm going to put the tablespoon of apple cider vinegar.
And the oregano. Oregano, sorry. Oregano.
Oregano? Isn't that like the Japanese paper making?
Oh. Hey, that's another Queen's English speaker. You're fooled.
And where's my salt?
I will just like commit harakiri here, basically. Just like.
It's for four margaritas talking.
It is. It's not four. It's three and a half.
All
All right, so that's in there.
We've
won that. So I bought.
So, Lynn, where are you in Australia? Are you in Brisbane or are you?
No, Noosa. So it's a couple of hours north, yeah. Drive time north of Brisbane.
Byron Bay, near Byron Bay.
Are you near.
No, north, in Queensland. Oh, north.
Okay. Are you near the big prawn near Ballina?
the big prawn, no.
Yeah, Ballina is my.
Is in New South Wales, so that's the state south from us.
Oh, south. Sorry, you're north. Okay, you're more towards Cairns. So,
well, 2 hours north of Brisbane. So we're southeast Queensland still, but yeah, on the beach. So.
Nice.
Yeah, it's good. We have our turkeys cooking for Thanksgiving today because we're doing it early because they don't get. The day's off.
Are you celebrating an American Thanksgiving or are you celebrating a local Australian Thanksgiving?
No, they don't. Australia wouldn't. They don't do. No, it's our American one, but we pick a weekend either before or after. We've picked today. So right. We've got our turkeys on the barbecue because the turkeys here are so tiny. Compared to what you get in the States.
Yeah.
So we do two different types of stuffing and then we've got all the trimmings and I've actually used part of one of Laura's recipes for a different apple pie this year.
Yeah.
I'll have to send you a photo, Laura. I'm really impressed with how it turned out.
Oh, awesome. Please do. All right, so we've got, this has been cooking for about 8 minutes. Gonna put it in here.
Nice.
And Laura, these recipes are on your site.
Yeah, sure are.
It's on our blog. You just click on the name of the.
Awesome.
Yeah, and I'll post the ones for the rest of the year. So I've got five different salsas, and.
I think I've had a pork chop done in this salsa before. Honestly, I'd never understood what this salsa was made of. So making it's really cool.
I mean, it's more chilies than I would ever put in a salsa, ever. It's super chilified. So
it's pretty common for a Mexican sauce, though. There's a Rick Bailey's recipe I do for enchiladas all the time.
Tracy, did you have a go at this one?
I'm just finding the song.
Does anyone want lunch?
Did I have a go at it?
Yeah.
No, I don't do chilies. I mean, no. I enjoy watching it being made.
It wasn't as powerful as I thought because I'm like a chili, kind of a chili phobe. I like sweat as soon as I see a chili. So, but it was really good.
I think I might try it, kind of mine it. Actually, I have guajillo chilies in my kitchen. I do, I cook a lot, so I have everything. So I might try a mild version.
I mean, I even put the 10 chilies in and I was thinking, should I put like 8?
And I'm there's thinking the one.
Big fat one, but the black one.
Yeah. I'm thinking one, maybe 1.5.
Oh, but it was good.
Really? Come on.
Super tasty.
Oh, really Lord. It's like chicken.
It would be.
You put two pussy guajillos in there then, you know.
I don't know.
These aren't that spicy. I think the spice comes from the arbol.
I did a simplified version, which was 15 of the del arbol, whatever they are.
Arbols.
So, yeah, I went full on.
Nice, 15. And you're still alive. That's a good sign.
Still alive. Yeah.
Wait, how did it turn out? What did you think of it?
It's good. I didn't chop the chili, peanuts enough, but it came out really good.
I reckon it would make really amazing, like, chicken satay, if you did that.
Satay, okay, for sure. Yeah, satay is great.
Because it's like a great satay, peanutty, spicy flavor, but not too hot.
And pork chops.
So, when I'm blending it, so I didn't wait till it cooled down. I just blended it. So if you do it, just put a paper towel over it. You don't want to put in anything that'll seal it, because you'll have peanut salsa on your ceiling. So just hold it. Same thing with a blender. If you're blending soup,
yeah,
you don't want to seal it because you'll have a soup on your ceiling. It will just, the heat will explode. So just keep it lightly with your hand and a paper towel.
No lid. You didn't use a lid. I used the lid. I got away with it somehow. I cool it down though.
Yeah, I'm not cooling it, so.
So you're making it in real time, so you're.
Yeah. So I'm gonna put the peanuts in, and then.
It's got that awesome Vitamix thing. I'm so jealous. Okay. Someday I'll get one. I know. Someday.
Six, seven. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Okay, it's just to add water. Add one cup of water.
This is if you're making this up as you're going along, Laura. I mean,
why would you say that? All right, pull it. Check the consistency.
While we're doing this, I'll make an ad for my favorite tortilla chip. You ever seen these before?
Have you?
Have a corn chip?
What brand is it?
God, it's so good. I have like
my
corn idea. Made with corn, soybean oil, and I don't know, just a dash of lime. It's so good. It also says joy, love, and light is included.
What is that, James? What are you holding up?
These are better corn chips. These are the...
It's casa sandwich.
I love these things. I don't know what... Yeah. I mean, look at... I've eaten a lot of corn chips.
These are better...
That's the Palm Desert, close to where you're at. So, I mean, good.
These are so much better.
Right? Are these the same?
No, these are better. These are better.
Oh, what?
Well, they have a head there. Oh, those ones are good, too. I mean... They're organic.
Certified organic.
Anything organic is always better, for sure.
Either way.
A little heavier. Are those the stone ground ones, too? I love the stone grounds, too. They're great.
No, Kevin, yours aren't organic. Yours are just
My favorites. This is my personal favorite. They're from, actually, it's from Laguna Beach, too. Look at that. It's a Laguna Beach company.
Nice.
Kevin, what brand is that, Kevin? I wasn't able to read the label.
Have a corn
chip. Oh, okay.
Have a corn chip. It's a Laguna Beach brand. It's like, well, I mean, I'm from SoCal, so I was like, I just love these. And then just list their ingredients: soybean oil, soy. It's just nice. That's it. Salt, lime. And you know, we all know everything from Laguna Beach is wonderful.
So, Laura, what's the verdict?
It's all the Greek yogurt.
Ooh, there it is. Oh my God.
My mouth
is on fire.
What?
It's fire. Have you had the salsa yet?
Here's what I found. If you find it's a little too hot, throw a few more peanuts in. That's what I did. And I got it right to where I liked it.
Yeah, but you could have put more, you could put water in it as well, because the water dilutes it and makes it.
Yeah, once you put the peanuts in, it brings the hotness down a lot.
Oh,
you know, don't eat it. You're not supposed to eat that early stage here, I don't think.
Oh, I'm on fire. I put the water in.
Exactly. Exactly.
Some lime.
That's why I'm on the fourth margarita right now, because I've been eating.
Okay, so I'm going to put some lime in there. See if that.
You put the lime.
Laura, have you put water in there yet?
Yes, she did.
Ooh. Okay.
Wow, it was good.
Lit.
Lit.
Oh, it's interesting.
No, it is. It's great.
Once you put the peanuts in, it'll make a big difference. It'll change it a lot.
They're in. The peanuts are
they're in. Oh, wow. Okay.
It's really good. And you put some corn chips and you need margaritas to balance it.
Yeah.
God, cheers, everyone.
Exactly. You'll catch me up.
But that's exactly what tequila does. Once you get those spices in your mouth, you have to drink tequila. That's what tequila is for, just to balance it out.
Margaritas. Okay. Oh my God. Thank you all so much for coming on. It was so great to see your faces and hear your voices.
So glad you resurrected this.
Christy doing this. Christy has a margarita at least. It's not very guava margarita, but
Christy, you're muted.
I was making margarita in the background. It's not guava, but it's mango.
I made your own.
Oh, nice. Mango.
Yeah, and I added jalapeno and cilantro to it.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's great. That's great.
With tahine. So I love making margaritas. It's one of my favorite things.
Well, my favorite is the Cabo margarita. There is a resort in Cabo that they do pineapple, cilantro, cucumber.
Oh, yeah.
Lime juice.
Yeah. I made that before. You shake it and it almost gets foamy on top from the pineapple juice. It's so good.
Wow.
So good. So good.
Mm. I'm going to look that one up for sure.
Margarita. When did we make the couple margarita? In May or June?
Yeah. We did in May. I think May or June. Yeah.
I missed that one. Let me tell you.
We can do it again.
Absolutely.
I just buy the coolest.
Tell us what's going on in Tahoe.
What?
Yeah, we're back in purple. So both Nevada County and Placer County, things are locking down. But I did get first day of North Star today, so I got one day of skiing in for the season right now.
Really?
Great job. Skiing is in.
Wow. That's amazing.
Wow. It was pretty nice up here. It was like some of the best early season skiing I've ever done. So.
Oh, that's amazing.
Where are you?
Where in Tahoe are you?
We're North Lake. We're in Tahoe Vista.
Okay.
So which resort is that?
We're closest to North Star.
Okay.
So you've been up there. You've been up there since March.
Up for a ski weekend on March 11th, and then all the shutdown happened. We just stayed. So yeah, we've been here since March 11th, basically.
That's amazing.
Nice.
You went up to ski for the week and never came home.
You got the and summer corn.
Again,
you come full circle.
Spring corn, and then boom.
That's amazing. Oh my gosh. Well, thank you so much for coming on. It's so great to see you.
Yeah, I'm really glad you started these up again.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're part of our lifeline, Laura.
Thank you.
When this all started, all the stuff came down, you were a lifeline for us every Friday. So
for us too. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you. All of you made it what it is. So
thanks, Laura.
And we can cheer that Georgia went blue.
Yay, yeah. Georgia! Yeah. We did it!
Thank you, Tracy!
Yes, we did it.
Tracy,
everybody's listening, sign up to do postcards or calling into Georgia to make sure that the Senate races
go
blue as well.
We have two races coming up. We want everyone to vote. If you know anyone that lives I live in Georgia now, I'm a transplant, I'm from California, so if you know anyone in Georgia or you think you know someone in Georgia, reach out to them, make sure they register for absentee ballots because we still have a lot of issues with lining up. Not this election, but the previous time I voted, I waited 4.5 hours.
Wow.
And I have friends on the last election that waited 8.5 hours.
That's nuts.
Yeah.
I have 150 addresses that I'm writing letters and postcards to. So seriously, We've got to get Georgia.
We've got those two. Those two are critical. So those are the two we're trying to flip.
Yeah. Awesome. Let us know.
Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah. Let us know what you do.
And Laura, awesome job. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks, Laura. Looking forward to seeing you in January.
Yeah.
Yes.
How about next Friday? Next Friday. Yes.
That too.
Yes.
Nice to meet you all. Have a great weekend.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks, Jenny. Woo! Thanks, Manuel.
Yeah.
Bye. I'm gonna stay till you shut me down, Laura. I'm here. I want that.
I'm still going.
Lynn, thank you. Lynn, thank you so much. It's so good to see you.
It's great to see you too, honey. And thank you so much. This has been great. And I'm sorry I've been coming and going, but yeah, really love that you're back, and it's loads of fun.
Thank you. Great to see you. Love your haircut.
Oh, thank you.
Have a great weekend. Happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah,
happy Thanksgiving. Yeah, happy Thanksgiving, everyone. Bye.
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 Bye. Hi, Manuel.
I'm staying.
Hi, Kev.
You can hang up. I can hang up. I'm going to stay and drink some margaritas today. No, I love this salsa, man. This salsa, I mean, I'm peanut nut job. So
it is spicy.
It's spicy.
Muy caliente.
It's not that bad. I mean, and if it's too spicy, add more peanuts to it and then blend it up.
No, Chuck, and let's put this in the jar so we can dig in.
Yeah, I'm gonna save my peanut sauce. I think that's like got a couple meals out of it, actually.
Oh, wow, it's delicious. You know, you can put it on grilled food. Let's get those chips.
Oh, yep, that's what I was saying. Pork chops. I would swear. I lived in Guadalajara for like 3 months, and this lady next door. Some of my friends were. I was staying in one house, and my friends stayed in this other house. And this lady next door, she was like amazing cook. I'm sure she did pork chops with this. For sure.
Did you guys live near each other in Vernon Heights?
Yeah, we're really close.
Oh. Yeah.
And you knew each other then?
Yeah, definitely. I walked by your house just the other day, actually. I was kind of hiking with Bosco. And I was thinking about, like, Laura used to live right here, you know?
Oh, I know. Yeah, so Kevin and I met, was it 2004 or 5?
Yeah, a long time ago. Yeah, I said, well, Paris was a much better setting than Bernal. Let's put it that way. Fuck that. Fuck, you know, Bernal's okay, but Paris, way better.
I can't believe you guys met in Paris. That's crazy.
Oh, man. Laura did this. Okay, I got to tell you, it was such an eye opener because I had never, ever done like a seven course. Well, I had done one 7-course meal, Dave Boulay in New York. That was like the one time I'd done like something like that. And then to see that at Laura's place, I was like, oh my God. Like someone did this at their house. It was just so amazing. And she presented.